God. And Christ is to dwell living by his life, not us living for him, but Christ in you, the hope of glory, and the reality that we are crucified so that Christ may live in us, and we would live as a temple, as we would live as a vessel, we would live as a branch, we would live as a body, all of those being vehicles of expression. And all of this in the Old Covenant is a picture to us of that reality. And we saw that when God set this whole thing up, you know, he didn't set up armies and this and that. He set up two main people and two main things, and that was as far as our involvement, and that was priests and Levites. And this the session that went before this was primarily dealing with the Levites. The priesthood is most focused on the high priest himself. And that's the one who ministers to God the Father. But the Levites ministered to the high priest. And the Levites had one main responsibility. And this was what God gave to them. And this is what I shared in the last session. God set up the Levites to make sure that no matter where the people of God went, no matter where they went, no matter what was going on, the Levites would see to it that a tabernacle, a habitation, was set up for God. And that was their responsibility. Folks, that's just a type and shadow of us who are not just supposed to gather together and talk about God and whatever, but that we make sure as Levites that we have a habitation for God, that he's living in us, not just living in heaven and blessing us. And that we are the vehicle of the life of Christ, that we are, and it says that, and I won't turn there, but it says it in Ephesians, that we are a habitation of God, and that this temple is growing up into that reality. That's what it's growing up into. It's growing up into a habitation of God. And so that these Levites, whenever God got ready to move, they said, we'll make sure he has a habitation. And so when he stopped, they said, let's put up this habitation. Let's make sure that wherever the people of God are, there's a habitation. Folks, there's a lot of preaching. There's a lot of emphasis out there. There's a lot of things that seem to be important to everybody. But there's one thing that's important to God, and he showed it in type and in shadow. When his people gather together, he wants a habitation. He doesn't just want people, you know, talking about him. He doesn't just want a service. He wants to be able to live his life in us. Best described by Paul in Galatians 2:20, when Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not I. Christ lives not for me, not around me. He lives in me. And folks, that's more than Jesus living in you. You are crucified so that Christ may live in you. Why else would he do that? So that there would be one owner of the house. You're not the owner of the house. You're the house of God. We are the house of God. You know, woo, we're the house of God. That means he lives his life in us. And that's the important thing. Not just that we have a family, folks, but that he has a house, that he And let me just say it as plain as I can, so that it's no longer you living. For God, it's Christ living in you unto the Father and glorifying the Father. And what's happening through this temple is that the Father is being glorified by the Son, not by our good works or our commitments or our whatever, but that habitation is clear cut wherever the people gather. There are Levites all across the world that preach one thing. You are not just workers for God. You are meant to be a habitation of God, and he wants to live his life through you. There are Levites, but now it is the true meaning of that. Now it's no longer the shadow, but we're looking at the shadow. It is the actual reality of that. And what we saw with Levi and the tribe of Levi was that they turned to the Lord and they got committed to whatever the desire of the Lord was. And I'm not going to re-preach that, but I'm going to tell you that the priesthood is what we call a Levitical priesthood. So that means all Levites are priests, but they have different offices. And the two main offices is the high priest and his sons minister to the Father. Everyone else ministers to see to it. He gets a habitation. And then the other thing that I mentioned earlier that we'll get into. And so you can look at the, turn with me if you would to Genesis chapter 49. We'll get into this, into the scriptures. Now, how is it that the tribe of Levi was chosen? I mean, here they are in the wilderness, and here they stand before God, and God says, I choose the tribe of Levi to be my priest and to be my Levites. They will minister to me, and they will always have one desire in their heart, not the desire for their life, not the desire for their ministry, but the desire to fulfill my ministry, which is to make sure that the people of God become a habitation, not just Christians. Can I get an oh me? I mean an amen. Not just Christians, but a habitation of God. And so you look at that and you say, what was so special about the tribe of Levi that they had become this thing? Well, first of all, let me just say the answer to that is nothing was so special about them. There was nothing special about them in themselves. And in fact, by natural tendency, you'll see in Genesis 49, look at verse 5. This is Jacob, and he's talking about his sons, Simeon and Levi. And the Levites and the priests, the Levitical priesthood, all came out of the tribe of Levi. So this is early. God is talking about Levi. And he says, Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitation. O my soul, come not thou into their secret, unto their assembly, mine honor. Be not thou united. Or you know what else that word is? Joined. What does the word Levite mean? Joined. Okay. United, for in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they hamstrung oxen. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath, for it was cruel. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. Okay, well, that doesn't sound too good of a start. That sounds like God is not real pleased with them, and they got some real problems. They've got cruelty, they've got anger, they've got self-will. Anybody have a problem with these things within your own being? Guess what? There's hope. We're going to find that there's hope. God warned the rest of the tribes about Levi's secret. You know, he warned the tribes about two things, his secret and his habitation. Did you see it? We read it. His secret and his habitation. So, what is the means whereby Levi could be actually, you know, taken from a place of cruelty and anger and self-will and be brought into a place of priesthood? How is that even possible? One question you'd ask is, how would God allow such people as this to carry his holy vessels? You know? How would that even come about? Well, the answer lies in the secrets. The answer lies in secrets, but not Levi's secrets, God's secrets, the secrets of the counsels of God. God is able to take Levi out of his secrets into God's secrets and take Levi out of his habitation into God's own habitation. And that's literally what happened. In other words, all that he was began to be changed, and it comes through oneness with the Lord. Oneness with the Lord. You have to change habitation. You have to change everything. And that only comes by, you know, being removed. All these instruments of cruelty are changed. And when you unite with him, all of a sudden you're responsible for God's holy instruments. That's a whole different thing. Your instruments are given up for God's instruments. and your habitation is given up for God's habitation. Folks, oneness is the answer, and I'll tell you this, oneness is the only hope for Levi, the whole tribe. But through it, God takes the worst. Through it, God takes people that are self-willed. Through it, God can transform anybody because you're changed from your image into His image. And the scriptures say that we are to be changed into the image of Christ, not just made better Christians. Changed into the image of Christ. All of this that we're reading here about Levi, types and shadows. The truth is, we are supposed to have entered into exactly what the tribe of Levi was all about. So, by the means of oneness, there is a complete reversal from Levi's natural tendencies unto relating through the Lord's life by oneness. And we wonder, why is this concept so important to Levites, New Testament Levites, that I am crucified with Christ? Nevertheless, I live, but not I, Christ lives. Because oneness and the exchange of life is the only hope for any true Levite. Look with me in the Gospel of John, and you begin to see this coming forth. We'll refer back to this later, but John 17. some of you have a little heading over John 17. What does your heading say? Christ's high priestly intercessory prayer. That's what it says in mine. Your Bible may be different. Many people call this prayer the prayer of the high priest. Okay, this is incredibly important, okay? Because we'll see later on, these Levites have been joined to the high priest, just like we've been joined to the Lord. John 17, let's look at verse 11. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. Look at verse 21. That they all may be one as thou art, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they may also be one in us. And then verse 22. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. This whole prayer, this is Jesus' almost last prayer. He's got a prayer request. And that prayer request isn't, make everybody saved. It's make us one with Him, that oneness may come so that, like a branch being joined to the vine, the life of the vine will fill every branch. Whatever's the life of the vine would become the life of the branches. Oneness. That's a oneness. That's a joining. And so this process started when, and this is what we dealt with in the last session of this. This process started with this tribe when they began to, the tribe of Levi began to take God's part when it came to that golden calf incident. And they stood on behalf of the Lord. And they were the only tribe that would stand with the Lord. They took the Lord's heart. They took the Lord's desires. They didn't say, well, we're this tribe, so this identifies us. Here's our standard. And then we're this tribe, and this identifies us. They said, we're with the Lord. Whatever your desire is, that's our desire. Not every Christian is like that. I can't explain that, but I can explain one thing. Levi was like that. The tribe of Levi was like that. It was in their heart. They chose the side of the Lord. You know, they're not better. They're just wise to choose the heart of the Lord. I just think that there's a wisdom with that. And so, to really see that, let's turn to Numbers chapter 8. Numbers 8 and verse 5. This begins to describe a process, and let me say this right up front. You remember what the Levites did when they stood with the Lord in the golden calf incident. What we are about to describe is a process of cleansing the Levites to be able to become those who stand for him in all situations. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to begin to go through this process of cleansing for Levites. But what I want you to understand, and I'll explain it a little further later, I want you to understand that when those original Levites, the original Levites, stood for the Lord and took the Lord's side against all of the congregation to stand for what was in the heart of the Lord, they actually went through this consecration. And I'll show you that. I'll show you that they actually went through this very stuff. But that was for the very originators. That was the original Levites. Do you know that a lot of times the original founders have a passion, a desire, a zeal that doesn't get passed down to the next generation? And if it does, it misses the next one then. You know, it doesn't go very far. And so God was seeing to it that everybody, you know, every generation didn't have to do the golden calf thing. He set up a situation where there would be a consecration for every generation. This is what all Levites would have to go through. But the founding fathers didn't have an organized ritual. But it was the same thing. It was identical. But it was something done in their hearts. It was something that was so them. You understand? Not just what you do, but who you are and who you have become. To secure that for all generations in the future, the Levites are set forth here in a process of how to get cleansed and what would be required to remove natural tendencies. And it's the application of this consecration that you have here. And so in verse 5, it says, "And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Take the Levites from among the children of Israel and cleanse them. And thus shalt thou do unto them to cleanse them. Sprinkle water of purifying upon them, and let them shave all their flesh, and let them wash their clothes, so that and so make themselves clean. Then let them take a young bullock and its meal offering, even a fine flour mixed with oil, and another young bullock shalt thou take for a sin offering." Okay, you following that? And let's just consider that for a minute. To make this transition for future generations, for future Levites, folks, we are the future Levites. We are the ones upon whom the ends of the earth has come. They were a shadow. I've had people say to me, "Oh, I wish I lived back in that time. Boy, how precious that was." Folks, they were just shadow people. We're supposed to be the real. We're supposed to be the real Levites. The true fulfillment of what God had in mind is supposed to be carried on the shoulders of those who are walking now with the Lord in a real way. And we'll see that as we go. Sprinkling of water. Shaving all the flesh. Washing your clothes. The sprinkling of the water. The water doesn't just wash away all the problems. We know that. The water is the washing of the water of the Word. It cleanses your carnal viewpoints. But the razor, and that's primarily what I really want to talk about, though we'll get into all of it a little more. The razor cuts off what proceeds from within us. Naturally. Does that make sense? The razor cuts off what proceeds out of our flesh naturally. Okay? He said, you got to apply the razor. and of course, both are dealt with. That which comes out naturally and also those carnal viewpoints. And those carnal viewpoints, you find that in the study of water baptism. Water baptism is a declaration of Jesus' death 2,000 years ago. Amen. And the water and the it says that in 1 John. I forget the exact wording of it, but it says that they bear witness in one. Okay. And so it agrees with it. It's 1 John 5:8. And it is how we apply the cross in our lives today, just as Levites had to apply it in their life. Just as they had to apply it, but they only had shadows and figures and things. We have the real application of Christ and Him crucified and how it's supposed to be applied. And that's one reason why people are all baptized individually. Why? Because everybody has to go through it individually. Everybody has to apply it individually. Everybody has to make sure that each person understands what this is about, you know. And is willing to identify with it and to bear it in your life. So, you know, Levi in Genesis 49, where we read right there, he represents self-will. But this cleansing here represents the death of it. The death of all of those things, cruelty, anger, all of that. How do you get rid of it? You crucify the person that has that. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But it's not I anymore. It's not I. It's not I. It's Jesus. Jesus. Jesus is the center. You know, I was thinking about this with gravity and how everything works. If you're a planet and you get close to the sun, as long as you don't get too close, gravity won't suck you in. If you get too close to the sun, I fear for you because you're going to be sucked in and become one with the sun. Jesus is the sun, by the way. I fear for you. Don't get too close to Jesus. You'll get sucked in and oneness will take place and you won't even see you anymore. You'll just see this big bright sun. So let's stay far enough back where gravity only has enough pull to keep us Christ-centered, sun-centered, going around, but not one. You understand? Gravity is such that it'll just keep all the planets going around. They won't enter into oneness. They'll just be Christ-centered. Well, folks, Christ-centered isn't necessarily Christ in you. You can talk, you know, Jesus is the head of my home and the da-da-da-da, I forget what the plaque says, but people have, Jesus is the, you know, da-da-da-da and all this kind of stuff. But, you know, I mean, he doesn't really get to make a lot of decisions there. Thank God you pray over your food. Thank God you have little lessons with your kids or something like that. But is it Christ? No, it's you for Christ. Thank God that you got caught, you know, at least you're not an asteroid wandering around in space. Come on, folks. God made all that stuff. That's not all accidental. You know, at least you got caught in His gravity and you are centered around the sun. But, folks, He wanted way more than that. He wanted way more than that. You say, well, if the sun dies, it'll form a black hole and everything around it'll be sucked in. But that's another story. Sorry. It is the same story. It's exactly the same story, but I'm getting way off here on other stuff. But I mean, it's what we're talking about here. It's a reality that is seen in nature, but it must be true in our lives. And how do you preach that to a wandering asteroid? You know, you don't. Levi found it in their heart. God said, who is on, you know, or Moses said, who is on the Lord's side? Yes. He didn't know. At that point, they were all worshiping golden calf. Every purpose for which he brought them out was violated, and the commandments were broken, so he just threw them down. Who? One tribe stepped forward and said, we're with you, Lord. We're with your purposes for bringing us out. Not just our purposes for coming out. And so that's the whole thing. All of this represents cleansing. And you know, let me just close that part off with Romans chapter 6. Very familiar scripture to many of you, but it's a good good scripture to look at. Romans chapter 6. And we're talking about the water here. And it's in verse... you actually should read from verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? I mean, folks, is that really what the plan of God was? Is the plan of God that we just keep sinning, but Jesus died so that we wouldn't go to hell for it? Well, that's what most people think the plan of, most Christians think the plan of God is. Romans 6 says what? Is that what we're supposed to do? God forbid. God's not for that. His plan is this. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer in it? Know ye not? Don't you know what the cross is about? Don't you know what baptism is about? Folks, he's talking to Levites here. Don't you know what that washing was about that you went through? Don't you know what that razor was about? Here's the question. Do we know what being a Levite means? And of course, we understand in the New Testament it is no longer the Levitical priesthood. It's not about the name Levitical priesthood or Levite. It's about fulfilling exactly what they represented in the heart of God. That's what it's about. Know ye not? As many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. So here you see the, the baptism. There you see an understanding that water baptism is an agreement, just like when they were washed in it, it is an agreement with an identification into what Jesus went through, and it applies to us. Now, the tribe of Simeon may not have received that. The tribe of Manasseh may not have received that. Ephraim may not have received that. All of those tribes may... But the tribe of Levi received it because that's what God said. This is your cleansing. This is your consecration. Not just the Red Sea. This water. This identification. This baptism into this. And so, once that water was applied, now they're supposed to bring the sharp edge of the cross into all natural growth that's in the flesh. Well, didn't Jesus say stuff like that? Take up the cross daily. If any man follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross. I mean, isn't that deny yourself? Whoops, some of me just grew out. Natural growth just keeps coming out. Well, don't worry about it. Keep applying the cross. Amen. Keep applying the sharp edge of the razor to every part of that natural growth. And so it represents the application of the cross, which cuts down anything that grows out from our flesh. Anything that finds its source out from our flesh. Now, let's just be honest. How many Christians are that committed? Well, I'll tell you, the tribe of Levi is. The tribe of Levi is. But how many? How many of the tribes are that committed? We're not talking about better or worse here. We're talking about the Lord's heart. We're talking about what is in God's heart. How many say, I care more about what he cares about than my plan for my life? That's the real issue. That's where the thing really applies. And it is an application, folks, when we see anything that's growing out from us, that we immediately apply the cross. Well, frankly, folks, a whole lot of people get upset when you do that. If you bring up the razor, nobody talks about the razor. Nobody talks about the cross as a razor. Let's talk about it as an event 2,000 years ago that really doesn't have much bearing on our lives, except it saved me from hell. Yay! My flesh is saved. All that comes from my natural growth can still live and breed. But I'm not going to go to hell for it. Grace abounds. Hello. Still glad I'm preaching today? I mean, for Levi, what did this mean practically? That means you take the razor and you apply it to all instruments of cruelty. You apply it to all anger. You apply it to all self-will. You apply it to everything that's found naturally in Levi. That's what you do. You know, Ephesians talks about that when it talks about, getting rid of all malice and deceit and bitterness and all this kind of stuff. Folks, you know why it's talking like that? Not randomly, not just saying, oh, we need to be better Christians. It's saying, if you're a Levite, you're supposed to be doing this. This is the way it works. What do you mean if I'm a Levite? If you're one who lives on this earth to make sure that wherever the people of God gather, that at least the word of we're supposed to be a habitation comes forth. Not I, but Christ is supposed to come forth. And so, the water and the razor, both of these are personal applications of the cross. And it's, they're seen in different aspects, but it's brought it brings to an end the flesh, just like Calvary did. And that's the understanding, and that's the thing that's important. And let's just face it, this reality of the cross, this great, wonderful teaching of Christ and Him crucified, this thing is really not of much value unless it's applied personally and practically. But who's going to do that? Well, Brother Randy preaches this and makes me feel guilty. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. I'm not trying to make you do it. I'm just trying to preach the Word of God. I mean, as I see it, you say, well, that's right. It's as you see it, but I don't see it that way. Well, maybe we're of different tribes. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. It's all the family of God, but you know what? I can't go against what God spoke to my tribe, and will not, and will be hated, and people can say whatever they will, but I'm not going to go against what God said to my tribe, and I'm going to keep gathering my tribe, and I'm going to do that because it's God, just like they ought to keep gathering to their tribe and be happy about it. But why do you got to hate Levi in the process? But nonetheless, that's going to happen. But stand for God, brothers and sisters. Stand for the heart of the Lord. Stand for the desires of the Lord. And you do that personally, practically, by pulling out that razor and consecrating, cutting off all that malice and anger and self-will and cruelty and all the things that come up out of that. I was thinking about Paul when he says the sentence of death was in us. Folks, the sentence of death is in all of us. And I don't just mean for what we've done wrong, but I mean the sentence of death is pronounced on the flesh. It was pronounced on the flesh 2,000 years ago and needs to be applied today. Yes. And tomorrow and yesterday. Amen. Every day. And carried out on a daily basis. Why? We're part of the tribe of Levi. This is what we do. This is part of our consecration. This is what God has called us to do. And that tribe is not going to be changed. Levi will be exactly the same unless they do this. You understand? The cross is a must for the tribe of Levi, for sure. Why? Because God is not assigning godly positions to ungodly people. You say, well, he did. They were instruments of cruelty. Yeah, but his plan is that they be crucified with Christ and Christ live in them. And that exchange right there is sufficient enough to please the Father. That's good enough. That's the plan of God. And, you know, it becomes a situation where we partake now of the cross the way Jesus partook of it 2,000 years ago. I am crucified with Christ, not that I will be. And for them, for Levi, because God and Levi are joined, because they are joined, then the desires of the heart of God go into those branches. The very things that God cares about the most are felt by those who are joined. Okay? Let's look in Exodus chapter 32. And here's the situation that happened with the golden calf. I'm not going to read the whole story because we spent last session really dealing with it a lot. But I want you to notice, you remember earlier I said that the original Levites did consecrate themselves, just like this latter generation had this ritual that they had to go through of consecration, that these guys originally, they did consecrate themselves. You remember me saying that? Well, verse 29 here will show that. Exodus 32, 29. For Moses had said, consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, that he may bestow upon you a blessing this day. I believe that their standing up for God was the equivalent of applying the necessary things to become consecrated Levites. I believe that's what happened. This first group did apply the water. They did apply the razor. They did all of that in a spiritual way. It was a heart thing. It wasn't just a ritual. Yes. Right.
They were actually doing it too.
They were.
So they came out immediately from
that. Right. Amen. So when God, and she said immediately, because the thing is, when Moses asked the congregation who was on the Lord's side, Levi left immediately and joined the Lord's side.
Yes.
There's no hesitancy. Okay? There's no hesitancy in that tribe. Again, that doesn't make them better or worse. It makes them Levites. And everything they did for God and the congregation. Did you hear what I just said? Everything they did for God and others that weren't where they were at, but it didn't matter. It's all one family. It's all Israel. But the tribe of Levi responded in heart to what they felt they got from the Lord. In fact, look in verse 25. When Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron made them naked unto their shame among their enemies, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, who is on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. And he said unto them, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side, and go in and out from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Israel did according to the word of the Lord, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000. And then Moses had said, consecrate yourselves. This is the application of the razor. Those who were totally into this, those that were the leaders of it, the instigators of it, the razor was applied to them, to that part of the body that had natural growth coming out of it. Can you see that? I mean, folks, the razor was a sword.
Yeah.
Okay? And it was applied to out-and-out flesh that offended God. Hello?
Yes.
They were there. They were into it. They were following exactly what the Lord had said. And God had told them, you know, if you'll cut off this gross, then I will bestow this day a blessing upon you. To be on the Lord's side, folks, is not just the surrender of self-will, which obviously was so prominent in Levi, but the surrender of your total self.
Yes.
And the surrender of all that would come forth from your flesh, man, that nobody can talk you into that. And let me just make something clear to you three people. Let me just make something clear. I'm not trying to talk anybody into this. My desire is to speak forth the word and trust that those to whom it is sent will hear it, and something inside will beat in with their heart in the same way as this. Not even as the same way with me. My goal isn't to get people joined to me. My goal is to get people joined to the Lord. And that may mean, like Stephanie, you know, going somewhere. That's joined to the Lord. That's following the Lord. There's nothing wrong with that. You do what's in your heart to do. You go to the place that's in your heart to do. You do that. There are no shackles. There are no shackles. But let us all do what's in our heart to do. And let us do it unashamedly, folks. Let us do it unashamedly. Even if people try to heap shame on you, you serve God with all your heart and your soul and your strength. Stephanie, we're talking about this. I said, you know, if somebody is real strong and everything and they're serving God with all this strength and everything, they're serving with all their strength. Amen? And if you're in a wheelchair and you don't have much strength and you're just going, oh, I can't serve like them. Are you serving with all your strength? Yeah, it's only that much. Is it all your strength? Yeah, but you're fulfilling the word of God. Stop whining. Go for God with all that you got. You know? Hallelujah. And so you have to realize when Levi went through and began to apply the sword, began to apply the cross, they weren't just cutting off parts that were bad to them. Folks, this was family and friends and whatever. This was, shall we say it, parts that were dear to them. And that's where it gets tough. And that's where some people don't like to hear this, but the ones that are supposed to like it. You know? I remember somebody said to me, all this teaching about the lamb, I hate that stuff. And da-da-da-da. And I thought, well, you're not following it. Why is it so bothersome to you? I'm the one laying down my life and not striking back. You ought to be happy I preach this. I'd have ripped your head off otherwise. Did I say that? No, of course I didn't. Have I ever thought thoughts like that? Yes. Would I ever act on it? No. No. But I'm just telling you, you know, people go, you're not required. Go live whatever you want. Nobody's demanding that of you. I'm the one living it. I'm the one that put, you want to see the demands. I put it on me. Major, where I won't reach out. I won't put my, they can do anything. Folks, they can do anything. And pretty much have. But they, you know, but they ought to be so happy I preach this lamb stuff, that I take this consecration seriously, that I will not defile my consecration. They ought to be just pleased as punch that I am a punching bag. Really? Come on. Why are you griping, man? You know? Praise God. Well, you cut off your desires, even your cherished desires, and you begin to take on the Lord's heart and the cherished desires of the Lord's heart in that way. And you know, I mean, modern day Levites, we do the same thing. We don't just cut off the bad parts, the negative parts. We cut off the flesh that operates in us. We do not, we are Levites. We're consecrated. We went through the consecration. We're going to not defile our consecration. If they do it, that's fine. They probably weren't Levites. Be free and be happy and get everything you want. But doggone it, I have to deal with my stuff. And I'm not really upset about that. I feel pretty strongly about it personally that I do that to my own self, you know? And sometimes that means you cut off parts that you're pleased with or that you love. But, and you can see that. Look over in Philippians. This is New Testament Levite talk here coming up. Okay, you with me? How much time we got left on the... Oh, God, we're going to have to do another one of these. You can see that I'm trying to get through this, can you not? I am not trying to drag this out. Am I like stretching words or anything? I'm really not trying to do that, to drag it out. Let's see. Philippians chapter 3, did I tell you 3? And verse 7. But what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. What? Yes. What? Not the bad things, the things that are gained to me. What kind of Levite, you know, let's just get down on Paul right now. You knucklehead, why are you putting this on us? Come on. Join with me as we attack Brother Paul. Why are you putting this on us? What things are gained to you? Well, you do that. I'm not a Levite. Well, some of you can't do that. You can't say that. It's not in you to say that. You could never go against that scripture or that brother, because something rings true of what he's saying in you, because you are today's fulfillment of what a Levite was meant to be to the heart of God. That's as clear as I know how to say it. So to gain, you know, as the Levites, to gain God's desires by oneness, to get his desires because there's a oneness that we've come in, we give up our best and we give up our most noble things. Okay, the Levites. Folks, when God appointed them to this task, that's pretty much all they did the rest of their life, was to make sure God had a habitation. Do you understand that? Do you know, it wasn't like that was like a job. That 9 to 5. They served God night and day. And they understood that. We accept this. This ain't no big deal to us. Can you see a tribe on the fringe out there going, well, we're going to go into town and hang out with the, you know, whatever. I'm afraid to say, but, but you know, we're going to go out and, you know, you want to come with us? Can't. And wouldn't if I could. This is my consecration. This is my consecration to the Lord. Would you have me violate my consecration? You know? Yeah, because it's making us uncomfortable. Stop being uncomfortable. Doggone it. You're the one that's getting into that position of being uncomfortable. We're Levi. You're whatever. Issachar. So go drive your car. You know, it doesn't matter. That's not important. So apparently Levi did understand, and they set about cutting off what God required. They really did understand this. Now, here's a good scripture. Go to the book of Malachi, chapter 2. Malachi 2. And, you know, people think, well, because you preach with conviction and we only see you in strength standing up in front of the church, you've got it all together, Brother Randy. Folks, if I had it all together, I wouldn't have missed this loophole in my pants right here. Now, you wouldn't have known because this vest is pulled down. But I'm just as flaky as anybody else. In fact, probably more so. But thank God I got the life of Christ. He's what puts me over. All right. So, Malachi, what did I say? 2. Malachi 2 and verse 4. And you shall know that I have sent this commandment unto you, that my covenant might be with Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. My covenant was with him of life and peace. Sounds good. I gave them to him for the fear with which he feared me and was afraid before my name. The law of truth was in his mouth, and iniquity was not found in his lips. Folks, he didn't say iniquity was not found in his actions. He walked with me in peace and equity and did turn many away from iniquity. The priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth, for he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. Now, this goes on, and this is, in truth, this book of Malachi is saying that the Levites ultimately didn't fulfill this. Why would that be? Because they were a shadow. We're the fulfillment. So it's saying now there's coming one, his name, you know, John the Baptist, and he's going to fulfill it, and Jesus is going to come after him, and, you know, he's going to cut down everything that came before at the roots, and he'll be the new tree and all this kind of stuff. But it is saying right here from God's own heart how precious Levi was to him. If you just, you know, you just see how it greatly touched the heart of the Lord, and it brought Levi on a completely new ground with God from that time forward unto this. It was precious to the Lord. Talk about ministering to the high priest. We'll get into that, but probably not today. How much time we got left back there? 6 minutes. All right, let's go to one more then that will go along with this, and we'll see how far we get with this. Deuteronomy chapter 33. This is similar to Malachi. Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse 8. We'll read 8 through 11 here. And of Levi, he said, let thy thummim and thy urim be with thy holy one, whom thou didst test at Massah, and with whom thou didst strive at the waters of Meribah, who said unto his father and to his mother, listen to this. This is when he stood for the Lord, and he said unto his father and mother, I have not seen him. Neither did he acknowledge his brethren, nor knew he his own children, for they have observed thy word, the Levites have observed thy word and kept thy covenant. They shall teach Jacob thine ordinances, and Israel thy law. They shall put incense before thee, and whole burnt sacrifice upon thine altar. Bless, Lord, his substance, and accept the work of his hands. Smite through the loins of them who rise against him, and of him who hate him, that they shall rise not again. This right here is Moses talking, and he also is deeply moved by that. I mean, this portion here is saying that Levi was striking down other members, other tribes. They did not even see their own parents. They didn't acknowledge their brethren. They didn't know their children. All they saw was one thing, God's heart. I'm with the Lord. I apply the razor to the flesh. Period. His claims are so with the Lord that all claims in the flesh are made null and void. That's it. Cut off. That's it. That's just the way that it is. And this is the high point for the tribe of Levi, because they didn't just stand with God in this one incident concerning a golden calf. But apparently when they did that, they shifted their whole focus, their whole desire towards the Lord. And this became who they were meant to be on a permanent basis. Now listen carefully. For Levi, not all tribes, for Levi, they left their ambitions. They left their plans. They left their hopes. They left all of that, and they literally, physically, but I mean spiritually and all other ways, they took up the Lord's hopes and plans and desires. And they found that in the heart of God, that God's plan wasn't just to bring all of them out of Egypt and give them a beautiful promised land that they could dwell in and everybody would be happy and live with prosperity and blessing. They saw way before they got to the promised land that God had a desire in his heart. And all they were doing was responding to the desire of their heart to be out of bondage and to live happily ever after. But the tribe of Levi was seeing beyond that and saying, you know what? God wants a habitation. We're all trying to get a habitation. We're all working on our habitation. We're all trying to make a home. We're all trying to find security. But that is a shadow of what's in the heart of the Lord. And the habitation he wants isn't this building or some other church building, it's us. The habitation he wants is a place where he can be at rest and not be under attack. Where he can be at rest and find comfort. If you will, sorry to put it this way, put his feet up and relax a little bit. Live in his house and not have visitors. See, and that's really even a wrong picture, because folks, we lived in this house before he got here, and we give him a room called a room in our heart. We give him a little room, and you say, come in and live, you know. Come in and live, and you can live in my house, but whatever you do, don't meddle with anything that's upstairs. My thoughts, my way of seeing. Don't go upstairs out of my heart up here. Don't start rearranging that. Just live in there and be happy that I gave you a room. You know. And I say, as a Levite, it can't be that way. If I die declaring this, if I'm beaten to death declaring this, this is still the truth. It will always be the truth. I didn't make it the truth, and I didn't discover the truth as if it's some deep, dark mystery. The Levites had it, and David figured it out from the Levites. David figured it out from the Levites. Hallelujah. I want us to have communion now. Is that okay? Want us to do, I sure hope I can find the, there it is. I want you to just take a few seconds to prepare your heart for communion. Each one of you doing that in your own way. You know what the scriptures say concerning this, and go ahead, Jennifer, if you'd like. I'm going to have Jennifer just come sing a song, and then we'll read a few scriptures.
Thank you.
Father, we ask your Spirit to guide us and to move us into a place with you so that the life of this, the symbols that we have here will be brought forth. And that, Lord, we will not just go through the motions, neither of communion nor of communion. Communion meaning the Lord's table, or communion meaning how we relate by Christ. Father, let your glory be seen in your people. If you would just make your way over and get the bread and the juice. If you'll just hold it and we'll all partake together. Of course, in this place, we believe in open communion, and that means that anyone who is born again and desires to partake, we honor that. And because in our hearts we are honoring the Lord in his death and in his resurrection. I'm just going to read a few scriptures. You don't have to turn there if you just pay attention to what they're saying. This is Paul out of Corinthians. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body, we are all partakers of that one bread. Behold, Israel, after the flesh, are not they who eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? And here when he says, the bread which we break, is it not the communion of his body? The communion of that body is not the body that died long ago. He proves that in the next verse when he says, for we being many are one bread and one body. He's talking about a communion of the life of Christ represented by the blood and the body, the bread. That we are one habitation. One body so that Christ can live. Not many bodies, one body. Not many individuals living in a body, but one body for the life of Christ. That he may dwell within us. And he says, look at Israel after the flesh. Because why would he say that? He says that because Christianity is not a new thing that has a new basis. Christianity is the fulfillment of the old pictures. And so he says, behold, look at it, see it, Israel after the flesh. Are not they who eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? And when we eat this, we're eating this sacrifice, and we're eating of the blood and the body of Jesus. That says that we are partakers of this same altar, this same death, this same process. We are part of that. And then over just a little further, still the same chapter, Paul says this, therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Notice the words again. Very specific. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Folks, let us keep the feast. Let us keep the feast. He didn't say let us keep the ritual of the Lord's Supper. The fulfillment of the Passover, this is it. It's the feast. It's the feast that God always had planned. But we leave the feast and we get into a ritual of a new concept that has nothing to do with the old. And yet, this is all drawn from it. In both scriptures, Paul refers back to the original and says, consider that so that you'll know what you're doing now. And most have no connection with the two. But Paul says here, therefore, let us keep the feast. Are you ready to keep the Passover feast today? Are you ready to do the real thing? And not just go through a ritual. But he says, but there are stipulations. Not with leaven, not with the old leaven. And you remember the feast, maybe you don't. Maybe it's never applied. Maybe you remember it soundly. And every time you have communion, you do that. But the requirement to eat of the Passover was that everybody went through the house, the home, the habitation. And they went through the whole house, the whole body, if you will, and they checked every shelf and every compartment, and they looked, because if leaven was in the house, they couldn't eat of it. He said, no leaven in the house, none whatsoever. Folks, he's saying, let us keep this feast by looking within ourselves. And you surely other scriptures come to your mind where he says, examine yourselves. Surely, there are many scriptures that flood your mind now in relationship to Paul saying these very same things that are in the Old Testament, but now we have come into the reality of this. Not with old leaven. And then he gets New Testament on us. Neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness. And just before I came, I looked up the word malice. It said, feeding a need to see others suffer. Go through the house. Go through your house. Go through your house and see if there's any of that leaven in there, because if it is, you are partaking of this unworthily, the way that the Lord describes. I'm not even going to read all. I'm just telling you, you're violating the very. You're not keeping the feast. You're violating everything that it's supposed to represent. Feeding like a monster on the inside of us, feeding a need to see others suffer. Extreme ill will or spite. Malice is extreme ill will. It's not just ill will and it's not spite. It's extreme ill will and spite. A desire to harm others. And so I asked the Lord, help me to really see that. And he said to me, not with the leaven of malice or wickedness. He said, malice is the desire, is a feeding and a desire to see others suffer. But wickedness is carrying it out. It's no longer a desire. Malice is only seen in the desire. But the wickedness is to carry out those desires to harm others, to see others hurt, to ruin their reputation, to talk bad about them, to make yourself look better in light of them, is just as much leaven as if Israel had a whole closet full of leaven and didn't clean it out of their house on the Passover. Let us keep the feast. And so I say to you, get rid of the malice. Get rid of all the things that would want to hurt somebody, want to harm somebody, want to talk bad about them, want to rip them down. This is not Randy's attempt to fix the body or stop things. This is the exact meaning of keeping the feast. We are the New Testament fulfillment of that. And for fear that you would go too deeply, I won't even go to the scriptures that talk about not judging yourself and not taking care of these things properly, but going ahead and eating and drinking. Take a few moments. Take a few moments before the Lord, before we partake. Hallelujah, Lord. The Bible says on the same night in which he was betrayed, the very same night that he was being betrayed by his closest friend, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body. This is me. This is you. This is us. This is the way we are." On the very night of my worst betrayal, of hurt deep by those that should have stood with me, I give my body. Take, eat in remembrance of me. You may take of the bread. And on that same night, he took the cup and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you." Shed for you. Drink. Father, we pray that just as the body of Israel had Levi and Issachar and Naphtali and Judah and Benjamin and all those different tribes, they were one body. And Lord, we know that you assigned different parts and different responsibilities to each section, and that there were those who didn't like Levi doing what they were doing and giving what they were given. And Father, the New Testament counterpart is that we are your body, and we all must stand before you. We all must stand before you for the commitment and consecrations that you've brought us to, that we be responsible for those things. No one else can answer for them except us individually. And that, Father, you said we would stand before you for our words, for our words. But then you gave us this way, this means, through the broken body and the shed blood, whereby not only we could be free from sin and forgiven, but we could be made one with you and be made your body, where we would all partake of being the same body. And though one be a hand and one be a foot and one be an eye and one be an ear, no jealousies would arise. No pride would arise. But we would just serve you with gladness and fullness of heart in the manner that you've called us. And so we honor the spirit of that in our communion. We bow our hearts toward you, Father, as the body of Christ, and as the life of Christ kneels us down before you. We say you are our Father. You are the Father of us all. We love you. We love your Son. And we love the body that he lives in. We ask you to bring us to more fullness and light that comes from your heart, and not head knowledge that comes from man. Be gracious to us. Lift up your countenance upon us and give us peace.